and work in the final analysis, right? Here you put, you basically say, well, some students, the actual was positive, the actual was negative. You do know that in this case, the sum, so this is the sum of all the students here and the sum over here. This is what we know so far, right? In actuality, out of the holdout data, 100 students had the positive event, 1,000 students had the negative event. The sum of all of your sample is 1,100. And if you have chosen this as the point where you're going to make the differentiation, then you would know that if you predict it to be positive, you would have an 80% in here and a 10% in here. Now, let's see if that's true. In both cases here, you took all of these guys and you predicted that they would have a positive event. But in reality, you only got 80% of the actual positives, and you happen to have got 10% of the negatives, right? So these are the negative events, the guys that you didn't want to have. So this would be what you have. Also, if you look at the graph the other way around, you would say that whenever you predicted them to be negative, this would be predicted as negative, this would be predicted as positive, this would be as negative. Whenever you predicted them to be negative, you got 20% that were actually positive, right? And you got 90% that were properly classified as negative, right?
So the 10% are the false positives.
The 10% would, exactly.
That actually are negative, but you're predicting as positive.
Exactly. So what you end up here with is these other guys, right? Now this axis here is the true positive rate, and this axis here is the false positive rate. Exactly what Alejandro said, right? So if you want to know what the axis means, this is the true positive, and this is the false positive rate, right? Because it's percentage, right? It's not absolute numbers. And I put them as percentages here. Of course, you could multiply 100 times 80% to get the absolute value, which is 80. And here it would be 20. And here it would be 100. And here it would be 900, right? Now, so here's the advantage of this ROC curve. In one curve, you're getting a family of confusion matrices that you can sort of semi-visualize by saying, well, if I put my cutoff point here, I will get 70%, let's say this is 70% of the true positives, and maybe 6% that are false positives, right? Now, the decision as to where you put your cutoff rate is really almost a business decision. Here's an interesting case. Imagine we're talking about cancer here, right? And we have 1,000 negative cases. How many positives, people have cancer out of 1,000 people? Maybe one or even less than one for a specific type of, cancer that they may be testing for, right? So one way to have a really very accurate test for cancer would be to say the cancer always says you're cancer-free, right? Because if 99.9% of the population is cancer-free, you could claim this test is 99.9% accurate. Every time I make a prediction with a 99.9% probability, it turns out to be true, right? They didn't have cancer. And it only fails 0.1% of the time. So fantastic accuracy. It's probably the most accurate cancer test that you could even think of in the market, right? Even if you say, so let's say you have, for every 10,000 people, only one has cancer. One test, 99.9% accurate, is to say nobody has cancer. Let's say you have another test, and in that test you say, that test is really, really good, by the way. It's going to say out of, 9,000, it's going to say that these guys are cancer-free, and two guys have cancer. and you happen to have caught the one guy with cancer every single time. This would be a fantastic test, right? You catch everybody with cancer, and you just happen to catch a, you know, an innocent guy also that also gives you the false positive in this case, right? The test showed them as positive, but it was incorrect, so it's false positive. So what would be the accuracy of this one? Same accuracy, because you made one mistake. You classified a guy who was healthy as having cancer, whereas in the other one you made another mistake. You classified a guy who had cancer as being healthy, right? So both of them are equally good. But probably a business person might say, you know what, I want this one because the other one is actually nonsense. Right, the other one doesn't really find me the person that I need to operate on or follow up on. But this one is very valuable. And if you make it like this, which I think would still be fantastic, right? You say three have cancer when in fact only one has, but you always catch the guy with cancer. Now this one has even less accuracy than the one. So accuracy is a really bad indicator of model performance. And by the way you calculate accuracy is you sum the guys in the diagonal and you divide them by this total. Because these guys were correctly classified, you predicted them to be positive and they actually were positive. These guys were also correctly classified, you predicted them to have a negative event and they had the negative event. So if you add them all up, these are all your successful predictions, and you divide them by the total, that's the accuracy. So that's the way to obtain that value. Now, there's only one problem, of course, with the way we converted this ROC curve into this confusion matrix. The percentages don't give you the whole story. The percentages, depending on these sums, will give you different accuracy values, which is more or less what I was referring to with that cancer thing. So you have to also keep in mind the total number of positive guys. In fact, Mark, if you could make a little change to your ROC thing and just give us how many positive, these guys, these sums, how many positive events we have and how many negative events we have. That is the only missing piece in the ROC chart that would allow you to create every single confusion matrix for every single cutoff point in your probabilities, right? So that's the only additional piece. Now, so this is ROC. The other thing that people talk about is AUC.
Does ROC stand for something?
Yes, response and
receiver.
It's an electrical engineering term that has nothing to do with this. It was invented before machine learning and all that. Yeah. So the name doesn't really mean anything for non-electrical engineers. I don't even know what it means. I mean, really, besides that. So there's another concept here that I do want to talk about, which is the AUC. Look, imagine you choose one of these positive guys. So these are the guys who actually show the positive event. You choose one at random, right? So you have a line here that you're going to draw anywhere, and you choose this guy. Let's say you chose this guy. It was a random choice. Then you go on this axis and you choose one of these guys, also at random. Let's say that you chose this guy here, right? Now, if you do that, if you choose a positive event and a negative event at random, completely at random, you end up, here is the intersection of this point and this point, right? You end up selecting one of these little rectangles here. Now, because the area here is 1, it's a 1 by 1 square, the probability of you choosing any one of these combinations of one positive and one negative is equal to this area, which is always going to be the same size, right? Because these guys have a 1/1000th of an inch, and these guys have a 1/100th of an inch at their height. So it's always going to be 1/100 times 1/1000 for every possible guy. Now, the question is, if you choose two guys and they happen to be under the curve, AUC, area under the curve, if they happen to be under the curve, how could you describe that choice that you made? And here is how you would describe it. So let me